Hello everyone, this is Elshad Hasanov. I'm Medical Oncology Fellow at MD Anderson Cancer Center. Today I'm here with Dr. Jonas, who is the professor in our GU department. He's expert in VHL disease, kidney cancer, and GU malignancies in general. Good morning, Dr. Jonas.
Morning, Elshad. Great to be here.
So today I want to discuss with you the biomarker research that is going on for the renal cell carcinoma. So what biomarkers are currently being analyzed in the renal cell carcinoma world?
So a number of different things are being looked at. And so clearly what we want is we want something that could tell us A, important prognostic information about the outcome of patients, B, whether or not there are some molecular features that are linked to one therapy versus another for the treatment of renal cell carcinoma. And I'll be frank, in 2020, at this point in time, we don't have any validated biomarkers yet.
And what are the currently areas of investigation that we hopefully will have some improvements in the near future?
So when we think about a tumor, we have the cancer cells themselves that have mutations or copy number, genomic copy number changes. Those changes in the cancer cell will then influence the immune microenvironment, as well as the endothelial cells, the blood vessel cells surrounding the tumor. And we sort of think about this interactive organizational structure. We have to kind of look at whether or not there are features within that that we can actually associate with either prognostic or predictive outcomes. What we've the way we break this down is we first of all ask the question of whether or not there are differences in immune infiltration in renal cell carcinomas, in different renal cell carcinomas. And the answer is yes. And there have been multiple studies that have been published over the past few years showing, for example, with Immotion 150, and now more recently, there was an abstract that was at ASCO, showing that there's clearly subsets of patients with renal cell carcinoma where we have immune infiltration rich versus immune desert. And there's also then some further classifications of immune cell present, but also myeloid cell, which is a subset of immune cells present as well. And these all seem to influence the behavior of the tumor. The second question then is whether or not any mutations that we see in renal cell carcinoma influence the immune infiltration. And fortunately, we do have some data there as well. We recently published a paper in Nature Communications showing that presence of PBRM1 mutations in renal cell carcinoma are associated with less of an immune infiltration. And this has also been shown in a paper that was published in Nature Medicine by the Dana-Farber group and presented at ASCO this year. And very similar data have been shown by other groups showing that PBRM1 mutations are associated with less immune infiltrates and more of an angiogenic blood vessel rich signature. The big question then is whether or not those features are in any way associated with response or lack of response. And this is where things start getting controversial and complicated. Immotion 150, which was a study looking at atezolizumab, a PD-L1 inhibitor plus bevacizumab against sunitinib, demonstrated that presence of PBRM1 mutations was associated with less of an immune response to checkpoint inhibition. But the data that were presented at ASCO this year showed that the presence of a PBRM1 mutation was associated with more of an immune of a response to immunotherapy, despite the fact that there were fewer immune cells present. So where we're left with now is I think we're starting to be able to dissect biology, showing there's a clear association between mutational subtypes and immunophenotypes. But in the future, what we need to do now is better understand how does this now relate to treatment response.
Okay, so this was a very good summary of actually what's going on. And I'm glad that you also summarized the data related to the PBRM1. So hopefully there are more researchers going to come up to validate all these ongoing studies, and soon we will be able to predict the response, and we'll be able to stratify the patients based on these biomarkers, which agents will be better to start with.
I fully agree, Elshad, and I think that as we generate more data, and what's great is that these larger phase 3 studies and also larger phase 2 studies that are being done now are now rich with genomic data that's going to allow us to perform more analyses and further clarify what the relationship is between the genomic features of the tumor, the immune microenvironment, and response to therapy.